In this video, we're gonna look at how I took these photos and we're gonna talk about 5 myths that beginners in macro photography believe but that simply are not true. This video is sponsored by Squarespace. So I get a lot of comments from beginners, and over the years I've noticed some patterns. There are some beliefs that many people who are beginning macro photography believe but that aren't true, and I'm kind of getting tired answering all these, so I'm gonna just go through them and talk about them. Myth number one: a tripod is essential for macro photography. No, it isn't. I couldn't even imagine using a tripod for the kind of macro photography I do, where I walk around out in the field trying to find insects or flowers to photograph. Setting up a tripod takes maybe 1 or 2 minutes if you want to set it up and point it and focus properly, and in that time the insect is long gone. And besides, you have a lot of wind and vibrations and stuff, which makes it simply unpractical to use a tripod, because yeah, the camera will be still but your subject will not be still. It will be moving slightly and it will be impossible to photograph it. So you definitely don't need a tripod. Just use the tips that I'm gonna tell you in the rest of this video and you will be completely fine without it. Myth number two: autofocus is helpful in macro photography. No, it isn't. Actually, since everything is moving around so much when you're doing macro photography, your camera moves because of your breathing and your hands shaking slightly, and usually the insect sits on a tree branch or a leaf that moves, all of this makes it very hard to get focus in the right place, and you want to minimize the number of variables you have. I like to keep my ISO at a certain level, I like to keep the aperture fixed, I like to keep the flash fixed, I like to keep everything fixed so that I can focus on imagining everything that moves. And having autofocus trying to keep up with your subject is just an annoyance, something that makes it harder. No autofocus on the market works well in macro photography. It simply isn't fast enough to keep up, and the autofocus systems aren't made for macro photography. So next time you're out, set your camera to manual focus, set the focus kind of where you want it, and then just try moving the camera instead to focus. That is a lot easier and you will have one less thing that fluctuates to worry about. The focus will be fixed and you will be able to find the right focus by moving your camera. And also, I just want to point out that it is completely normal to miss focus on like 90% of your shots. That is what it's like in macro photography, and it's okay. Myth number three: the best flashes for macro photography are ring flashes. No. I used to believe this myself as well. When you're beginning in macro photography, you search for the right gear, and then you notice that Canon, Nikon and some other manufacturers have these really expensive, like $400 ring flashes that are made for macro photography. So you think they are made for macro photography, then they must be the best ones, right? And also, they cost so much money, they must be great because they are so expensive. But yeah, sure, they will light your subject very well, but you will get a kind of industrial look to your lighting and it will not be soft and smooth as you want it to be. It will just look like crap. So a lot better to buy a cheap flash for like $60 and then use something thin and translucent and white as a diffuser, and you will get very nice soft light as you're seeing here. And it will be cheap, and yeah, you will also be able to use your flash for other kinds of photography. So don't buy into the ring flashes, they are not that good, especially if you want to take photos that look beautiful. Get something simpler, get a normal flash, and you will thank me later. Myth number four: a macro lens with a long working distance is very important. No. And I used to believe this as well when I was a beginner. I saved up for a long time to be able to afford the very expensive Sigma 150mm macro lens, because that one has one of the longest working distances. And it's natural to believe this, because when you're a beginner you notice that all the insects just fly away when you're trying to photograph them, and you get so frustrated and you're thinking, if I only had a lens with a longer working distance, I wouldn't have this problem. But guess what? You will have it even with a longer working distance lens. The secret is to just keep practicing. If you do macro photography for one or two summers, you will be better and better at approaching insects without scaring them away. And then you will be able to get very close. I mean, these days I don't care about working distance at all. It's just as easy to photograph an insect at 4 centimeters as it is at 15 centimeters. If they're getting scared, they're getting scared either way. And it can actually be a downside to have a long working distance, because then it is harder to find the subject in your frame when you're further away from it. With a shorter working distance, it's a lot easier because you know exactly where the focal point is and it is directly in front of the lens, so it's much easier to find stuff in your viewfinder, which is otherwise kind of a big problem when you're doing high magnification macro photography. So these days I don't care at all about working distance. As long as I get like 3 or 4 centimeters, I'm good. And even with lenses such as the Lauva 50mm wide angle macro lens, where you have basically zero working distance, it's completely possible to take very close up shots of insects. So chill about the working distance. Myth number 5. A high shutter speed is needed for macro photography. No. Again, I get lots of comments about this. How can you take photos with a slow shutter speed and still have them sharp? And the answer is very simple. You just use a flash. And the flash is very, very fast, like 1/10,000th of a second. And if it stands for the majority of the light in your scene, it will freeze the action and the shutter speed will not matter that much. Here you see a photo taken at a fast shutter speed and usually get a very dark background because the flash stands for most of the light in the scene. Here you see the odd example where a slow shutter speed doesn't work. You see this like black shadows around the spider, and that is because there is a lot of light besides the flash in the scene, so they are kind of competing and the slow shutter speed will make this drag shadow. But if you just make sure that you're covering your subject in some way so that the sun doesn't shine directly on it, in most cases a slow shutter speed will work great. This is at 1/60th of a second. And as you can see, the photo looks sharp and nice, and you even have this nice blue background, which is possible thanks to the slow shutter speed. So just use a flash, don't have it at max capacity because then it will be slower. The lower the power you have your flash on, the faster it will be and the better it will be at freezing any action. So actually I would say as a default I use 1/30th or 1/60th or sometimes 1/250th of a second, and either of those are good as long as I'm using a flash. And I need to use a flash anyway because I need to have a small aperture so that I can get an up depth of field. So yeah, just use a flash and you're good. And here is another example of the kind of nice background colors you can get when you're using a slow shutter speed. This video is sponsored by Squarespace. This is my website over at mwroll.com, and as you can see, it is very stylish, minimalistic, and just like I want it. And that is thanks to me building it with Squarespace. They have so many templates in different genres. They have lots of great templates for photographers. But basically any website you want to build, they have a beautiful design for it, ready-made. And it's so easy to add pages, to edit pages, to upload photos, to do anything you want with your website. They have great analytics tools and yeah, basically everything you need. Go try it for free at squarespace.com, and when you're ready to use it for real, use my code Micael Widell for a 10% discount. Thank you, Squarespace. So those were the 5 main myths that I keep hearing again and again from beginners, and I just want to make a video to address them all. And besides that, I'm really happy today because I've been looking for jumping spiders now for like a couple of weeks, and yesterday I found my first one ever. You're seeing it in the beginning of this video, and then the day after I actually found another jumping spider. And it's so nice, I've never found them before despite doing macro photography for 4 years. I'm not sure if it's because I usually don't look for spiders that much, but that will definitely change now. They are so cute and adorable, and I just want to go out now, look for even more jumping spiders. People tell me they usually sit on like wooden surfaces in the sun, like trees and fences, but actually I found both of the ones I found during the last 2 days, I found them on tree branches in the shadow in the forest, so I'm not sure. Anyways, thank you so much for watching, please subscribe, I post new macro photography videos every week, and go visit me on Instagram, mwroll is my name there. That's it for this video, thanks for watching, over and out, bye.